Story 23 of Abaft the Funnel by Rudyard Kipling. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Story 23, A Death in the Camp. Two awful catastrophes have occurred. One Englishman in London is dead, and I have scandalized about 20 of his nearest and dearest friends. He was a man nearly 70 years old, engaged in the business of an architect, and immensely respected. That was all I knew about him till I began to circulate among his friends in these parts, trying to cheer them up and make them forget the fog. "Hush!" said a man and his wife. "Don't you know he died yesterday of a sudden attack of pneumonia? Isn't it shocking?" "Yes," said I vaguely, "awfully shocking. Has he left his wife provided for?" "Oh, he's very well off indeed, and his wife is quite old. But just think, it was only in the next street it happened." Then I saw that their grief was not for Strangeways deceased, but for themselves. "How old was he?" I said. "Nearly 70, or maybe a little over." "About time for a man to rationally expect such a thing as death," I thought, and went away to another house where a young married couple lived. "Isn't it perfectly ghastly?" said the wife. "Mr. Strangeways died last night." "So I heard," said I. "Well, he had lived his life." "Yes, but it was such a shockingly short illness. Why, only 3 weeks ago he was walking about the street." And she looked nervously at her husband, as though she expected him to give up the ghost at any moment. Then I gathered, with the knowledge of the length of his sickness, that her grief was not for the late Mr. Strangeways, and went away thinking over men and women I had known who would have given 1,000 years in purgatory for even a week wherein to arrange their affairs, and who were anything but well off. I passed on to a third house full of children, and the shadow of death hung over their heads, for father and mother were talking of Mr. Strangeway's end. "Most shocking," said they. "It seems that his wife was in the next room when he was dying, and his only son called her, so she just had time to take him in her arms before he died. He was unconscious at the last. Wasn't it awful?" When I went away from that house, I thought of men and women, without a week wherein to arrange their affairs and without any money, who were anything but unconscious at the last, and who would have given 1,000 years in purgatory for one glimpse at their mothers, their wives, or their husbands. I reflected how these people died, tended by hirelings and strangers, and I was not in the least ashamed to say that I laughed over Mr. Strangeway's death as I entered the house of a brother in his craft. "Heard of Strangeway's death?" said he. "Most hideous thing. Why, he had only a few days before got news of his designs being accepted by the Burgoyne Cathedral. If he had lived, he would have been working out the details now, with me." And I saw that this man's fear also was not on account of Mr. Strangeways. And I thought of men and women who had died in the midst of wrecked work. Then I sought a company of young men and heard them talk of the dead. "That's the second death among people I know within the year," said one. "Yes, the second death," said another. I smiled a very large smile. "And you know," said a third, who was the oldest of the party, "they've opened the new road by the head of Tresillian Road, and the wind blows straight across that level square from the parks. Everything is changing about us." "He was an old man," I said. "Yes, more than middle-aged," said they. "And he outlived his reputation?" "Oh, no, or how would he have taken the designs for the Burgoyne Cathedral? Why, the very day he died..." "Yes," said I, "he died at the end of a completed work, his design finished, his prize awarded." "Yes, but he didn't live to..." "And his illness lasted 17 days, of 24 hours each?" "Yes." "He was tended by his own kith and kin, dying with his head on his wife's breast, his hand in his only son's hand, without any thought of their possible poverty to vex him? Are these things so?" "Yes," they said. "Wasn't it shocking?" "Shocking?" I said. "Get out of this place. Go forth, run about, and see what death really means. You have described such dying as a god might envy and a king might pay half his ransom to make certain of. Wait till you have seen men, strong men of 35 with little children, die at 2 days' notice, penniless and alone, and seen it not once but 20 times. Wait till you have seen the young girl die within a fortnight of the wedding, or the lover within 3 days of his marriage, or the mother 60 little minutes before her son can come to her side. Wait till you hesitate before handling your daily newspaper for fear of reading of the death of some young man that you have dined with, drank with, shot with, lent money to and borrowed money from, and tested to the uttermost, till you dare not hope for the death of an old man, but when you are strongest, count up the tale of your acquaintances and friends, wondering how many will be alive 6 months hence. Wait till you have heard men calling in the death hour on kin that cannot come, till you have dined with a man one night and seen him buried on the next. Then you can begin to whimper about loneliness and change and desolation." Here I foamed at the mouth. "And do you mean to say," drawled a young gentleman, "that there is any society in which that sort of holocaust goes on?" "I do," said I. "It's not society. It's life." And they laughed. But this is the old tale of Pharaoh's chariot wheel and flying fish. If I tell them yarns, they say, "How true, how true." If I try to present the truth, they say, "What superb imagination!" But you understand, don't you? End of story 23.